to the first panel, which is called Human Rights Defenders and Democrats in East and West, What Support is Needed. I am Yana Zavano, I'm an analyst with the European Stability Initiative, and today we have four excellent speakers, guests from Azerbaijan, from Russia, and from the UK. They will share with us their personal first-hand experiences of activism, of human rights defense in their countries, of analyzing authoritarian governments. But the key question that we'll try to answer today is, why should Europeans care about these issues, and what can be done today? Okay, before we start our presentations, let me say a few words about each of the participants. We have Turgut Gambar, who is one of the founders of NIDA, of this youth civic movement, whose members were just sentenced to this very long term, less than a month ago. And Turgut was very active in campaigning for the release of Adnan and Emin in this video that we just saw. Then we have Emin Milli, who is a former political prisoner, who is currently managing Meydan TV. It's an independent online TV channel that he established last year, and this channel tries to provide an alternative viewpoint to the state-controlled Azerbaijani media. And then we have Dmitri Makarov from Russia, who is a well-known human rights defender. He's the co-chair of the largest youth human rights organizations in the region, and he focuses in particular on freedom of assembly and freedom of association. Recently, he traveled to Crimea on a human rights field mission. And finally, Ben Judah from the UK. He's a writer and a journalist. He's the author of an acclaimed book on Putin's Russia, The Fragile Empire. He has reported extensively in Georgia, in Kazakhstan, in Kyrgyzstan, and many other post-Soviet countries. And he's been very critical of the West's weak response to Russia's actions in the recent Ukraine crisis. Okay, and then we can start with Turgut.
Thanks a lot, Yana. Yana just introduced me, so I'll just start. The previous presentation was pretty good, just to show what is happening in Europe with regards to political prisoners in general and in Azerbaijan in particular. There are different views of how many exactly political prisoners are there in Azerbaijan, but we can be sure that there is somewhere around 100, maybe more, maybe less. But the most important point that there are so many political prisoners, and their number is continuously growing, especially after January of 2015, after the resolution of Mr. Strässer was voted against in the Council, in the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe. Neither activists, eight of them, were arrested in March and April of 2013 after protesting against the deaths of the conscripts in the army, non-combatant deaths. And this, for me in particular, and for NIDA in general, this was an experience of how to work, how to campaign for political prisoners, what things need to be done, and what are the things which we miss, which we need support in. I'll try to be as short and concise as possible and to talk with good points. One of the biggest problems that we've been facing is obviously the financial side of this situation, because there's so few lawyers who are ready to take on political cases and who are going to protect political prisoners. All of them are working pro bono. They're not getting any money, they're not getting any financial support for us for representing our members in the court, and sometimes they're just giving their own money to the guys and just to support them. The same goes for the families. It might sound very, very, as a simple thing, but prison visits, just to going to the prison every week by their families and bringing them food, bringing them medicine, bringing them clothes. goes. It's a it's the thing that takes a lot of finances. It's a thing that needs to be addressed. The second issue, very important issue, is the media support. In the case of Emin and Adnan, we were able to gather a lot of media support. During recent arrests, with respect to recent cases, be it the case of Umar Mamedov and Tofik Yakubu or Anar Mamaldi or Nida case, the same attention, we weren't able to gain the same attention. I don't know the exact reasons, but for sure this issue needs to be addressed as well. It's very important in a sense of support to the political prisoners as well. It's like every time we talk with them on the phone or personally or during the court meetings, they always ask about the international attention, what is being written about them, and every single article or footage on international TV, international media outlet is very important moral support for them. And this issue needs to be addressed in some way, and the international media needs to give more attention to the issue of covering political prisoners problem. The third important point is how Council of Europe has lost its credibility, lost its status as a human rights champion in Europe. It has been a victim of caviar clause, as it was mentioned in the previous presentation, and it just doesn't look the situation is going to change anytime soon, because the way the balance of powers in the Council of Europe is currently being held, not much has changed since January of 2014. The issue, the fact that Azerbaijan is currently chairman of the Council of Ministers at the Council of Europe, is a chance to move things forward. Is a chance to bring the Azerbaijani government to more international exposure, to more media attention, to more criticism. This has worked before during the Eurovision, as you know, in 2012. As some of you may know, in 2012, Sing for Democracy campaign was launched prior to the Eurovision, which was held in Baku, and it was a great chance to gather a lot of international media attention. This chance was taken, and in fact, I think this campaign was successful. The same can be done and should be done with regards to the chairmanship of Azerbaijan, and the same international attention should be given to this country again. And lastly, I would like to make a point about the European Court of Human Rights. For me, as a person who has done his master's on human rights, European Court is a structure which is supposed to deal with issues of sophisticated nature, where thorough debate on various issues is necessary. But in the case of political prisoners, everything is so clear. Like, the cases of political prisoners are a case of blatant violation of human rights, and it's wrong that so many years are needed to address these cases in the European Court of Human Rights. I know about the procedures, I know that it has its own guidelines, and it takes a lot of time, but either there should be a different approach to political cases in the European Court of Human Rights, or a completely new body should be established within European institutions, and the countries should be pushed to comply to the judgments of this new institution, as they do with the issue of European Court of Human Rights. So for the start, these are the main remarks I would like to make. Later, I think my colleagues are going to say things about the issue of political prisoners as well, and then we'll get the questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Turgut. Thank you especially for reminding us about the aspect that is often overlooked, about the financial side of the issue. that actually it's not only political prisoners who need support, but also their lawyers. I mean, just to give you some examples from Azerbaijan, in 2011, three lawyers who defended opposition figures were disbarred. Another one was accused with some fake charges and then jailed for 8 years. Yet another one was arrested in Istanbul as he was returning from an OSCE conference. So it's a dangerous business to be to defend opposition figures. And as well, of course, the families who, as we know, the families of this young eight NIDA men are in very dire financial circumstances right now, and they do need support as well. So our next speaker is Emin Milli, who is a former political prisoner himself. And Emin, it's been 4 years approximately since you've been free, so to say. Do you think it's different, the situation now? And also, since you're managing this independent TV channel, Meydan TV, what are your ideas about what can be done today in the situation that we have now?
Thank you very much for inviting me and having this opportunity to share my thoughts about specifically what can be done about the problem of political prisoners in Europe. You know, we were talking about mobilizing public opinion in Europe and maybe in the world about this problem. I think we have, in a way, to thank Mr. Putin, because he has done in recent months such an amazing work in mobilizing international media attention, international public attention on issues that many activists, human rights defenders have been talking for years and years, but unfortunately they were ignored. Other people who were talking about economic engagement of countries, authoritarian countries like Russia and Azerbaijan, about understanding of Putin, they have been respected, they have been listened to, and today we have the result. We have, I would say, another fascist country on the eastern flank of Europe re-emerging. And for me, I don't put here any difference between Putin or Aliyev or Lukashenko. These are people of the same religion. They are preaching the very same values. They are talking the same language. If you watch Russian television or if you watch Azerbaijan state television, it's the same propaganda that Europe is full of gays, it is in collapse, it is going to collapse very soon. It's poor, everyone in Europe are prostitutes and gays, and it's going to be end of the world if we don't save Europe. So now we have a situation, Aliyev, one dictator, is chairman of the Council of Europe. I think any conscious European should feel deeply ashamed when you just realize what is Council of Europe, what sort of history it has, what sort of ideals and values actually it was designed to stand up for, and where it is now. And I think Gerald has shown very well, very specifically, all the problems that have to do with this current situation of Azerbaijan being the chairman of the Council of Europe. But look, I'm a former political prisoner. I've been in jail once, 6 months. Another time I was more lucky than our friends. I spent in January, February, just 15 days. That was my second very short imprisonment. And then in March, many of our friends have been jailed. And unfortunately, they are sentenced now for 8 and 10 years. The situation in Azerbaijan is deteriorating with a cosmic speed. Aliyev is feeling more confident when he sees the situation in Turkey, in Russia. Just, you know, he feels the absolute green light in becoming even more authoritarian, even more blunt and more honest in what he does and what he stands for. And so I was thinking always, what can be done in this situation? I think that every, I've looked at the agenda that has been proposed here, it come together, the proposals that we have to help families of political prisoners, very important. We have to help lawyers that help those families, very important. The appointing new rapporteur of political prisoners, very important. All these issues are important. But for me, one very important thing that I'm missing here is institutional approach. We have to look at the roots of the problem. Why is it that Putin or Aliyev or Lukashenko or these authoritarian regimes are so strong now that they are chairing, you know, the most respected human rights organizations in Europe? Why there is still this debate in even in Germany, you know, that actually who is Putin? We have to understand Putin. Very respected people, at least who were respected before, like former German prime ministers, you know, not one, you know. They are basically serving these authoritarian regimes. Of course, it's put in some contracts and deals, but these are the threats that are existential threats. We're not just talking about political prisoners in Azerbaijan or in Russia and Ukraine. I think this issue is broader, and this is how it should be presented to media, because otherwise media, German media or, you know, French, British media or American media, they will never get interested, you know, in who is this one or two prisoners in this or that part of Europe. What is interesting is existential security threat that is there for Europe, because all the issues that Gerald was talking today and that many human rights defenders organizations have been talking today for so long have been ignored for so long. So I see solution in institutional approach, and I will talk about one specific area. I think there will be many brilliant ideas. I think after my personal experience, I mean, spending 16 months in jail and losing my father while I was in jail, having my friends in jail who have been sentenced now have to spend maybe 8, 9 or even more years in jail. I think that it is not enough just to, you know, highlight the problem at one conference, at one seminar where all the same people are coming together. It is very important that we can reorganize, regroup, that we can find allies in Europe, in Russia, in Azerbaijan, everyone who shares the same values. And I don't think we are a minority, we are actually still a majority if you take the whole of Europe. But we have to mobilize everyone, business, governments, you know, individuals, students, exactly as partly these people were, or groups have been mobilized in the campaign for my and Adnan's release. But this is not just enough to demand someone's release. I think the key issue is free and independent media. I absolutely believe that if in the 90s there would be free and independent global media in Russia established within and outside of Russia, you know, when the internet started to march in all this post-Soviet space, if a very sophisticated network, you know, of with elements of traditional TV channels and social media, bloggers, citizen journalists would be worked on and would be promoted, if money would be invested in there, if public opinion in, because Gerald was talking about mobilizing public opinion in Europe, and I mean, probably you were talking, as I understand, about kind of democracies, right? But I think it's also very essential, and actually to look at the root of the problem. And the root of the problem is that public opinion in countries like Azerbaijan and Russia, and, you know, and also Ukraine was the case until recently and partly even now, is manipulated by huge investments, you know, huge investments that Kremlin puts in media, in propaganda media. So I think everyone by now realizes, of course, that Europe lost this information war to Putin, but I think now it's time to start doing things in the right way. And I can tell you one small example from Azerbaijan. After I came to Berlin, because I have seen that it is impossible to create infrastructure in Azerbaijan, every NGO is shut down in Azerbaijan, people are jailed, sentenced. So I decided to create infrastructure here in Berlin. And today, within just 1 year, we have 15 people, with very small resource, we have 15 people people working in Berlin and in Azerbaijan, and we have 10,000 views on YouTube daily. I've done it with very, really, very, very small resources. I absolutely believe that there are enough partners, NGOs, journalists, citizen journalists, businesses, rich people, governments that could do it and should plan it, should start designing a new sort of a media for ex-Soviet space. I think it should be first of all in Russian, because look, Putin invests $350 million annually in Russia today, and it gives its results. There is much more money invested in bloggers, in comments, in many other things that are, have impact. You know, 2 days ago I was sitting in Berlin and talking with a group of German journalists, nice people, having barbecue, drinking beer, and they were telling me that they think that Spiegel is not balanced enough, that Russian position is not shown enough there. That where, like, this guy didn't know that the whole Russian propaganda about fascism in Ukraine has just been destroyed by the fact that one Jewish candidate had more votes in Ukrainian elections than two fascists. You know, they had together less than 2% of votes in recent Ukrainian election. So these sort of facts, if you think they are known to every ordinary Russian or Azeri, you know, and Russian is still lingua franca in this region, there is a huge need and demand for this. And what we have seen is a constant, you know, decline in investment in civil society, in independent media in that region. And I think now is a high time to rethink the strategy and to get the act together and to start to invest strategically in a very planned manner in independent media in Russian language and in local languages in the post-Soviet era. The last sentence I want to make here about the structure of such a concept. I think we had at some point the CNN era, then there was Al Jazeera era, and I think now this is where we can start in ex-Soviet space. We can start a Wikipedia sort of TV network where it will be based in Kiev, but the network itself will be functioning, you know, small bits and parts of it all over ex-Soviet Union space. And we should involve a lot of citizen journalists, bloggers, because in spite of all the repressions, in spite of all the aggression against individual liberties in these countries, in Azerbaijan, in Russia, in Belarus, in Central Asia, in all of these countries, there are still people who are risking their lives and their freedom for and fight for freedom of speech in these countries, for freedom of media, and for release of political prisoners. So this is my contribution to today's debate. I think that we, while again confirming importance of all the issues that Turgut was talking about and have been listed in this agenda, I think we have to keep in mind the institutional approach in supporting independent media and civil society in these countries is a key to have real results in the years to come. Maybe it will take 1, 2, 5, 10 years, but we have to build this up. Because otherwise, it's not that we are anything like democracy or human rights or individual liberties, they are spreading in the, you know, in Europe. It's just the opposite. It's a far right, it's fascist, you know, are coming to power and getting more popular even in the Western.
Reminding us especially about the role of independent media in counteracting this very strong propaganda that we all encounter in the media space. So now we've heard from our two speakers from Azerbaijan, and we can switch to Russia, to Dmitri Makarov, who is a human rights defender and has very extensive background on the human rights situation in Russia as well as in other post-Soviet countries. So Dmitri, what do you think are the main problems and what would be some of the good solutions to the situation we have today?
I do come from Russia, but I represent an international youth congress movement, which is a network working throughout the post-Soviet space. And as I speak now, one of our fellow was actually in prison in Belarus, getting 10 days, serving 10 days in prison for participating in food not bombs action. And as we speak here today, there are new searches going on in Moscow within the framework of Bolotnaya case, so-called Bolotnaya case, cracking down on those who have demonstrated against Putin's inauguration back in May 6, 2012. There's been a new wave of searches, a new wave of arrests, adding to a line of people who are in prison already and come on trial for voicing their dissent against the authoritarian practices in Russia. And this is the most massive, the most largest politically motivated trial going on in Europe today. Unfortunately, receiving very little attention in the media. And as we speak here today, there are two activists from Crimea brought by FSB to Moscow, charged with terrorism, with attempt to bomb offices of United Russia in Crimea. They are Ukrainian citizens. Both of them are blamed to be part of the right sector of the new fascist group, while one of them is an anarchist and anti-fascist activist, and another is a movie maker and a director of films. None of them has to do with any nationalist activity, but they are being charged and will face several years in prison. While we speak, the courts in Moscow have been handing out verdicts in cases where human rights NGOs have been trying to contest the label of foreign agents that have been placed by them on them by the Russian government. Those are NGOs that have been charged with being engaged in political, so-called political activity, by the very fact that they, for example, submitted reports to the UN human rights bodies, or that they have collected information of how many people have been detained during political rallies. So those are the cases that are being developed right now in Belarus, in Russia, and those are the cases that we have to deal with. And what do those stories tell us about what's going on in Europe in general? Those stories tell us that there's a constant and determined effort to narrow the space for civil society, to narrow freedom of assembly, to attack freedom of association, to shut down freedom of expression, whether by foreign agents laws, whether by attempts to criminalize activity of non-registered groups, whether to attempts to criminalize assemblies, and whether by attempts to shut down bloggers and internet media outlets. Secondly, it tells us about the fact that human rights defenders and human rights as a concept are under direct attack. Human rights defenders are being imprisoned. This year, August 4th, will mark actually the third year when Alice Bilyatsky, probably the most well-known human rights defender in Belarus, will serve in prison on charges brought by the Belarusian government, but by the information that they have received from Lithuania and Poland, in fact. It also tells us that the concept of human rights has been attacked directly in a twisted way using the new Orwellian newspeak language because the Russian government claims to defend the human rights of Russian speakers in Ukraine, in Crimea, and so on. While using the language of human rights, by framing the claims into that language, the governments of that part of the world have been using everything that they have at their disposal to crack down on the very concept. Thirdly, it tells us about the fact that the international institutions have constantly been failing their mission, that EU members have been largely complacent to the things that are going on in Council of Europe, as has been showed to you during the previous presentations, that the Council of Europe, the OEC, the very bodies that have been created to safeguard human rights, to promote rule of law, and to promote standards by carrier diplomacy and focus more on trade and business than on human rights. And I think it's time to send a message that Europe does not end at the European Union borders, that Europe includes those countries that are outside of European Union, including those who may not even want to be part of the European Union, that Europe should be based not on trade and economy, but should be based on common values. And this is what Council of Europe is about. And this is what OEC that has been shaped just as much by human rights movement as it has been by the governments is about. And I think there's another lesson that all those stories tell us about, that the human rights movement also has been divided and has been very displaced in its response to recent challenges. Right now, many of my Ukrainian friends and colleagues, my fellow human rights defenders, are studying not only the Ukrainian criminal code, but also the Russian criminal code, because those are the charges that will be brought against them, some of them, and against some of their friends and colleagues that are left in Crimea, that is now under de facto Russian jurisdiction. I think that there is a need to bring to respond to the authoritarian international of dictatorships with a new human rights international. And things, problems that are going on with human rights in Belarus are just as much a problem for Russians and Ukrainians as the problems that they have in their own countries. But the problems of Azerbaijan are not only the subject of concern of people from Azerbaijan, but also of those who are working on similar issues in other countries as well. And I think, a lot has been said already in the media and the public discussions about the recent developments in Russia, about the Putin regime, which that is becoming more and more authoritarian. But I think it's quite easy to lay blame on Putin himself and on Russia in particular. But I think we need to look at other issues that have been allowed such things to happen. I think Putin is a Russian phenomenon, but Schröder and Schröderization of politics is a German phenomenon. Front National is a French phenomenon and a European phenomenon. Jobbik is also a European party. And it's no surprise that those parties that I've mentioned have sent their observers to legitimize the so-called referendum in Crimea, for instance, and have been in close alliance with the United Russia and the ruling party in Russia. And I think one other message that I wanted to voice now in the presentation that opened this panel, there was a mention of the Helsinki movement that has helped to shape the human rights landscape of the European continent, that has helped to bring the OEC together to what to pay attention to the human dimension basket of security. I think it's time to remember that the Helsinki movement has been started in the Soviet Union by the great dissidents that have actually brought a government to live to the things, to the standards that has put on paper. And it is by no coincidence that the first Helsinki movement, Helsinki Group, was actually founded in Moscow by the name of Moscow Helsinki Group. And it is no coincidence that an American Helsinki Group was also founded by the same person that was among the founders of Moscow Helsinki Group, Emin Milli, who's still one of the most respected human rights activists living today. American Helsinki Group was the one to become Human Rights Watch later on. And I think it is important to remember that this is history, but it's also important to remember to think that we may need a new Helsinki movement, which may be named differently, but should bring together activists from both East and West in a common effort to bring back the value of human rights to Europe, to bring strength and renewed voice to international institutions, to remind them of what they have been created for, and to give a new voice to the human rights concept and to the human rights movement. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Dmitri, for your presentation and for giving us an overview of what's happening as we speak, not only in Russia, but also in Belarus, in Crimea, and in other places in the post-Soviet space. Our next speaker is Ben Judah, and Ben, you're probably the person who knows most about Russia. You've traveled to the most remote corners of my country. And you've been very, very critical of how the West has responded to human rights violations in Russia. And your recent op-ed actually said that the UK government failed to impose sanctions on Russia and Britain was laundering oligarchs' dirty billions. Do you have ideas for what could be done concretely in the West in the face of the situation we have today? Thank you.
Thank you for that very flattering introduction. And thank you for inviting me to Berlin. I'm really happy to be here because I like being in powerful capitals. Now, let's take a very long step back. Let's imagine ourselves well beyond the year 2024, when Russian historians of the future will look at us in the present. Because future historians will identify the last 2 years as the decisive ones, the turning point Russia's post-Soviet history, when Russia morphed from authoritarian state into an autocracy. The decisive month was December 2011, and the decisive day was December 24, 2011. Putin feared his own Maidan. He feared his ouster. Moscow had 100,000 of the best educated Russians demanding change. There was a fragile civil society knitting itself together across the continental country. The internet, long left uncensored, was alive in dissent. The middle class wanted to make inputs. Left to themselves, these trends would have pushed Russia forward. But they were not. This is when Putin began his war, his most important war, the war of the state against society. Victory for Putin in this war has been simple. Russia must reduce its free space. Russia must suffocate its emerging society. Russia must strangle its emerging politics. And victory for Putin in this war has been achieved through fear. Through fear, Putin has redefined what is acceptable and unacceptable in Russia. One by one, these pieces have fallen into place. Acceptable and unacceptable assembly has been redefined. With illegal protest laws promising crippling fines. Acceptable and unacceptable protest has been redefined, with the terrifying Columbine Square case terrorizing random protesters with labor camp sentences and indefinite detention. Acceptable and unacceptable stunts have been redefined, with the Pussy Riot show trial and the labor camp sentence. Acceptable and unacceptable activism has been redefined, with show trials crippling the opposition leader, Alexei Navalny. Acceptable and unacceptable political funding is being redefined, with the financial backers of Navalny being exiled, hounded, humiliated. Acceptable and unacceptable investigations are being redefined, with the Navalny organization being decapitated in this way. The pieces have been falling into place, and the Russian opposition called to Berlin to make use of its Brussels. And Berlin did not make use of Brussels. The walls were closing in. Acceptable and unacceptable internet was redefined, with the illegal content registry and newly unlimited powers of surveillance. Acceptable and unacceptable media was redefined, with a free online TV station Browder practically unplugged. Acceptable and unacceptable society has been redefined, with the NGO law hazing organisations and shuttering threats. In the first year of the war, the Kremlin was nervous of its work. Cosmetic concessions were offered. But in the second year, 2013, the Kremlin were pleased. They looked at what was done and they felt satisfied. Acceptable and unacceptable loyalty has been redefined, with a new treason law extending to any form of dissent. This is how we went from the Russia of 2011. Do you remember that Russia? I think I vaguely remember it. The Russia of the Skolberg High Technology Park, and Medvedev talking about freedom being better than unfreedom, to the Russia of today, where a giant poster hung in the art back with the faces of traitors painted upon it, the faces of Democrats. The war between the state and society has ended almost in victory for Putin, and the war has been easily won because society was weak. The state did not need to move beyond crippling warfare. It did not need to break the new society in the war. They managed to break the new society in the course. Law was turned into a weapon to distract and disable activists. But in central Moscow, that traitor banner still hangs. The Moscovites remember when traitor banners still hung in their capital. This is why Russia's opposition fears a dramatic explosion in the number of political prisoners in the years ahead. And this is why Russia's opposition has been calling repeatedly to Berlin to make use of Brussels. But this has not come to pass. So let's go back to the historians of the future. What have these historians written? What will these historians have seen in hindsight that we missed? Future Russian historians, especially Democrats, will surely be very anti-Western. Because of Russia's offshore elite. The textbooks of 2030 will explain in their opening chapters how between 2000 and 2010, they consolidated a form of absolute power with absolute freedom and the long-term consequences of its actions in Russia. This is the offshore elite. The power broker in Russia rules tyrannically in the East, but puts his wealth, his wife, his son, his daughter in the West. The power broker who has built a system. The moment that he can pillage no more, he can simply flee to the West. Knowing your private jet and your London mansion is always waiting changes the way we treat society. Knowing the money is in Austria and in the British Virgin Islands changes you. Knowing this means you do not need really to develop Russia, because you're not trapped in Russia. Like the elites of Britain, France, and Germany, generations ago, were forced to democratize and stabilize a society and lose their assets. If you're part of this offshore elite, you do not need to worry.
Time is running out. We want to discuss the matter, not the bomb.
See, that's extremely rude just to interrupt my efforts. If you're part of this offshore elite, you do not need to worry about property rights. You don't have to worry about developing your cause. You don't have to worry about your children face in that country, because they will grow abroad. Now let me explain to you how Russian corruption actually works. Russia's elites are not really empire builders, they're asset strippers. Russia's elites are not really patriots, they're plunderers. But where does this money actually go? Russia's seen over 600 billion in illicit capital outflows. And where is this money heading? The minimum 40 billion every year Russia itself estimates in illicit outflows. The money doesn't go to China. The money doesn't go to Iran. Yes, the money comes here. The money comes to the European Union. Because the European Union is an alliance of tax havens. Britain, Holland, Austria, Andorra, need I go on? Latvia, Cyprus, Monaco. These are the countries where money is laundered by European bankers, by European lawyers, in European states. Malta, Luxembourg, Ireland. Do you get the picture? Does Germany face up to this? That it effectively controls the European Union of tax havens? Does Germany realise what this means? That as long as Europe remains a union of tax havens, there is no point in really talking about battling Russian autocracy or Russian corruption with our foreign ministries and human rights funds, because our bankers and our lawyers are enabling Russia's offshore elite. Because EU member states are acting as giant washing machines for Russian money. And I think we're better than that. Which is why we need to push for a radical answer. Take the principles of the Magnitsky list, which are visa sanctions and asset freezes on criminals, and apply them for a new EU mechanism to Russian officials, perhaps officials of other European countries and signatories to the European Convention on Human Rights, who are violating these laws. ESI has proposed a piece of legislation that I'm very excited about, which would establish a panel of former judges in an organisation funded by specific new member states to whom NGOs would submit lists of officials it believes are violating fundamental human rights in Russia and in other Eastern European countries, that could then submit a list of proposed banned individuals to the European Council, which has the power to visa ban individuals. And this would be the beginning of developing a mechanism where we could attempt to control grants of short. I think this is hugely important if we want to be able to face up to the Russian historians of the future, to show that we took measures to prevent the pillage of Europe, to prevent the pillage of Russia, and to hold people accountable for doing that, who would hold people accountable for doing that in the West.
Thanks a lot, Ben, for outlining this proposal. Just to summarize, a panel of judges who would advise the European Union on which human rights violators to sanction in the form of visa bans. So, to sum up our panel, we heard from two Azerbaijan speakers who stressed that this important international media attention is extremely important and actually is becoming more difficult to obtain for the recent cases of political prisoners, that financial support is crucial for the lawyers, for the families, that independent media is key to giving people access to different opinions, to countering the propaganda which is extremely well financed by authoritarian government, as a means figure of $350 million invested in Russia Today yearly shows. And we heard that these developments with political prisoners are getting only worse in countries like Belarus, and now more recently in Crimea as well. And Ben told us about where the Russian elites hide their money, hide their livelihoods. And we have a proposal, a very concrete proposal for visa bans, for a panel that would advise on whom to punish in the framework of the EU. So thanks a lot to all the participants. I think the time for our panel is out, and so we can then go to the second panel, which Gerald Knaus will lead, about what can be done today in the situation that we have now.
Thank you very much for inviting me and having this opportunity to share my thoughts about specifically what can be done about the problem of political prisoners in Europe. You know, we were talking about mobilizing public opinion in Europe and maybe in the world about this problem. I think we have, in a way, to thank Mr. Putin, because he has done in recent months such an amazing work in mobilizing international media attention, international public attention on issues that many activists, human rights defenders have been talking for years and years, but unfortunately they were ignored. Other people who were talking about economic engagement of countries, authoritarian countries like Russia and Azerbaijan, about understanding of Putin, they have been respected, they have been listened to, and today we have the result. We have another fascist country on the eastern flank of Europe re-emerging. And for me, I don't put here any difference between Putin or Aliyev or Lukashenko. These are people of the same religion. They are preaching the very same values. They are talking the same language. If you watch Russian television or if you watch Azerbaijan state television, it's the same propaganda that Europe is full of gays, it is in collapse, it is going to collapse very soon, it's poor, everyone in Europe are prostitutes and gays, and it's going to be end of the world if we don't save Europe. So now we have a situation, Aliyev, one dictator, is chairman of the Council of Europe. I think any conscious European should feel deeply ashamed when you just realize what is Council of Europe, what sort of history it has, what sort of ideals and values actually it was designed to stand up for, and where it is now. And I think Gerald has shown very well very specifically all the problems that have to do with this current situation of Azerbaijan being the chairman of the Council of Europe. But look, I'm a former political prisoner. I've been in jail once, 6 months. Another time I was more lucky than our friends. I spent in January, February, just 15 days. That was my second very short imprisonment. And then in March, many...
The Kremlin pleased. They looked at what was done and they felt satisfied. Acceptable and unacceptable loyalty is being redefined. With a new treason law extending to any form of dissent. This is how we went from the Russia of 2011. Do you remember that Russia? I think I vaguely remember it. The Russia of the Skolberg High Technology Park, and Medvedev talking about freedom being better than unfreedom, to the Russia of today, where a giant poster hung in the art back with the faces of traitors painted upon it, the faces of the Democrats. The war between the state and society has ended almost in victory for Putin. And the war has been easily won because society was weak. The state did not need to move beyond crippling warfare. It did not need to break the new society in the war. They managed to break the new society in the course. Law was turned into a weapon to distract and disable activists. But in central Moscow, that traitor banner still hangs. The Moscovites remember when traitor banners still hung in their capital. This is why Russia's opposition fears a dramatic explosion in the number of political prisoners in the years ahead. And this is why Russia's opposition has been calling repeatedly to Berlin to make use of Brussels. But this has not come to pass. So let's go back to the historians of the future. What have these historians written? What will these historians have seen in hindsight that we missed? Future Russian historians, especially Democrats, will surely be very anti-Western. Because of Russia's offshore elite. The textbooks of 2030 will explain in their opening chapters how between 2000 and 2010 they consolidated the form of absolute power with absolute freedom and the long-term consequences of its actions in Russia. This is the offshore elite. The power broker in Russia rules tyrannically in the East, but puts his wealth, his wife, his son, his daughter in the West. The power broker who has built a system. The moment that he can pillage no more, he can simply flee to the West. Knowing your private jet and your London mansion is always waiting changes the way you treat society. Knowing the money is in Austria and in the British Virgin Islands changes you. Knowing this means you do not need really to develop Russia, because you're not trapped in Russia. Like the elites of Britain, France, and Germany, generations ago, generations ago were forced to democratize and stabilize a society and lose their assets. If you're part of this offshore elite, you do not need to worry
about... Time is running out. We want to discuss the matter, not the bomb.
See, that's extremely rude just to interrupt my efforts. If you're...
Attention in the media. And as we speak here today, there are two activists from Crimea brought by FSB to Moscow. Charged with terrorism, with attempt to bomb offices of United Russia in Crimea. They are Ukrainian citizens. Both of them are blamed to be part of the right sector of the new fascist group, while one of them is an anarchist and anti-fascist activist, and another is a movie maker and a director of films. None of them has to do with any nationalist activity, but they are being charged will face several years in prison. While we speak, the courts in Moscow have been handing out verdicts in cases where human rights NGOs have been trying to contest the label of foreign agents that have been placed by them on them by the Russian government. Those are NGOs that have been charged with being engaged in political, so-called political activity by the very fact that they, for example, submitted reports to the UN human rights bodies, or that they have collected information of how many people have been detained during political rallies. So those are the cases that are being developed right now in Belarus, in Russia, also the cases that we have to deal with. And what do those stories tell us about what's going on in Europe in general? Those stories tell us that there's a constant and determined effort to narrow the space for civil society, to narrow freedom of assembly, to attack freedom of association, to shut down freedom of expression, whether by foreign agents laws, whether by attempts to criminalize activity of non-registered groups, whether to attempts to criminalize assemblies, and whether by attempts to shut down bloggers and internet media outlets. Secondly, it tells us about the fact that human rights defenders and human rights as a concept are under direct attack. Human rights defenders are being imprisoned. This year, August 4th, will mark actually the third year when Alice Bidatsky, probably the most well-known human rights defender in Belarus, will serve in prison on charges brought by the Belarusian government, but by the information that they have received from Lithuania and Poland, in fact. It also tells us that the concept of human rights has been attacked directly in a twisted way using the new Orwell.
Sorry, I see that's extremely rude just to interrupt my questions. If you're part of this offshore elite, you do not need to worry about property rights. You don't have to worry about developing your courts. You don't have to worry about your children facing that country, because they will grow abroad. Now let me explain to you how Russian corruption actually works. Russia's elites are not really empire builders. They're asset strippers. Russia's elites are not really patriots. They're plunderers. But where does this money actually go? Russia has seen over $600 billion in illicit capital outflows. And where is this money heading? The minimum $40 billion every year, Russia itself estimates, in illicit outflows. The money doesn't go to China. The money doesn't go to Iran. Yes, the money comes here. The money comes to the European Union. Because the European Union is an alliance of tax havens. Britain, Holland, Austria, Andorra, Milan, Latvia, Cyprus, Monaco. These are the countries where money is laundered by European bankers, by European lawyers, in European states. Malta, Luxembourg, Ireland. Do you get the picture? Does Germany face up to this? That it effectively controls the European Union tax havens? Does Germany realise what this means? That as long as Europe remains a union of tax havens, there is no point in really talking about battling Russian autocracy or Russian corruption with our foreign ministries and human rights funds, because our bankers and our lawyers are enabling Russia's offshore elite. Because EU member states are acting as giant washing machines for Russian money. And I think we're better than that, which is why we need to push for a radical answer. Take the principles of the Magnitsky list, which are visa sanctions and asset freezes on criminals, and apply them for a new EU mechanism to Russia's officials, perhaps officials of other European countries and signatories to the European Convention of Human Rights, who are violating these laws. ESI has proposed a piece of legislation which would establish a panel of former judges. Which would establish a panel of former judges in an organisation funded by specific new member states to whom NGOs could submit lists of officials it believes are violating fundamental human rights in Russia and in other Eastern European countries, that could then submit a list of proposed banned individuals to the European Council, which has the power to visa ban individuals. And this would be the beginning of developing a mechanism where we could attempt to control and corral this offshore elite.
Prime ministers, not one, they are basically serving these authoritarian regimes. Of course, it's put in some contracts and deals, but these are the threats that are existential threats. We're not just talking about political prisoners in Azerbaijan or in Russia and Ukraine. I think this issue is broader, and this is how it should be presented to media, because otherwise, German media or French, British media media or American media, they will never get interested, you know, in who is this one or two prisoners in this or that part of Europe. What is interesting is existential security threat that is there for Europe, because all the issues that Gerald was talking today and that many human rights defenders organizations have been talking today for so long have been ignored for so long. So I see solution in institutional approach, and I will talk about one specific area. I think there will be many brilliant ideas. I think after my personal experience, I mean, spending 16 months in jail and losing my father while I was in jail, having my friends in jail who have been sentenced now, have to spend maybe 8, 9 or even more years in jail. I think that it is not enough just to, you know, highlight the problem at one conference, at one seminar, where all the same people are coming together. It is very important that we can reorganize, regroup, that we can find allies in Europe, in Russia, in Azerbaijan, everyone who shares the same values. And I don't think we are a minority, we are actually still a majority if you take the whole of Europe. But we have to mobilize everyone, business, governments, you know, individual students, exactly as partly these people were, or groups have been mobilized in the campaign for my and Adnan's release. But this is not just enough to demand someone's release. I think the key issue is free and independent media. I absolutely believe that if in the 90s there would be free and independent global media in Russia established within and outside of Russia, you know, when the internet started to march in all this post-Soviet space, if a very sophisticated network, you know, of with elements of traditional TV channels and social media, bloggers, citizen journalists would be worked on and would be promoted, if money would be invested in there, if...
because they were ruled. Now let me explain to you how Russian corruption actually works. Russia's elites are not really empire builders, they're asset strippers. Russia's elites are not really patriots, they're plunderers. But where does this money actually go? Russia has seen over 600 billion in illicit capital outflows. And where is this money headed? The minimum 40 billion every year Russia itself estimates in illicit outflows. The money doesn't go to China. The money doesn't go to Iran. Yes, the money comes here. The money comes to the European Union. Because the European Union is an alliance of tax havens. Britain, Holland, Austria, Andorra, Milan, Latvia, Cyprus, Monaco, these are the countries where money is laundered by European bankers, by European lawyers, in European states. Malta, Luxembourg, Ireland. Do you get the picture? Does Germany face up to this? That it effectively controls European Union tax havens? Does Germany realise what this means? That as long as Europe remains a union of tax havens, there is no point in really talking about battling Russia, autocracy or Russian corruption, or our foreign ministries and human rights funds, because our bankers and our lawyers are enabling Russia's offshore elite. Because EU member states are acting as giant washing machines for Russian money. And I think we're better than that, which is why we need to push for a radical answer. Take the principles of the Magnitsky list, which are visa sanctions and asset freezes on criminals, and apply them for a new EU mechanism to Russian officials, perhaps officials of other Eastern European countries and signatories to the European Convention of Human Rights, who are violating these laws. ESI has proposed a piece of legislation which would establish a panel of former judges in an organisation funded by specific new member states, to whom NGOs would submit lists of officials it believes are violating fundamental human rights in Russia and in other Eastern European countries, that could then submit a list of proposed banned individuals to the European Council, which has the power to visa ban power to these banned individuals. And this would be the beginning of developing a mechanism where we could attempt to control grants offshore aid. I think this is hugely important if we want to be able to face up to the Russian historians of the future, to show that we took measures to prevent the pillage of Europe, to prevent the pillage of Russia, and to hold people accountable for doing that. We would hold people accountable for doing that in the West.
Stability Initiative. And today we have four excellent speakers, guests from Azerbaijan, from Russia, and from the UK. They will share with us their personal, first-hand experiences of activism, of human rights defense in their countries, of analyzing authoritarian governments. But the key question that we'll try to answer today is, why should Europeans care about these issues, and what can be done today? Before we start our presentations, let me say a few words about each of the participants. We have Turgut Gambar, who is one of the founders of NIDA, of this youth civic movement, whose members were just sentenced to this very long term, less than a month ago. And Turgut was very active in campaigning for the release of Adnan and Emin in this video that we just saw. Then we have Emin Milli, who is a former political prisoner, who is currently managing Meydan TV. It's an independent online TV channel that he established last year, and this channel tries to provide an alternative viewpoint to the state-controlled Azerbaijani media. And then we have Dmitri Makarov from Russia, who is a well-known human rights defender. He's the co-chair of the largest youth human rights organizations in the region. And he focuses in particular on freedom of assembly and freedom of association. Recently, he traveled to Crimea on a human rights field mission. And finally, Ben Judah from the UK. He's a writer and a journalist. He's the author of an acclaimed book on Putin's Russia, The Fragile Empire. He has reported extensively in Georgia, in Kazakhstan, in Kyrgyzstan, and many other post-Soviet countries. And he's been very critical of the West's weak response to Russia's actions in the recent Ukraine crisis. Okay, and then we can start with Turgut.
Thanks a lot, Jana. Jana just introduced me, so I'll just start the presentation file. The previous presentation was pretty good, just to show what is happening in Europe with regards to political prisoners in general, and in Azerbaijan in particular. There are different views of how many exactly political prisoners are there in Azerbaijan, but we can be sure that there is somewhere around 100, maybe more, maybe less. But the most important point is that there are so many political prisoners, and their number is continuously growing, especially after January of 2015, after the resolution of Mr. Strasser was voted against in the Council.
In Europe, in Russia, in Azerbaijan, everyone who shares the same values, and I don't think we are a minority, we are actually still a majority if you take the whole of Europe. But we have to mobilize everyone, business, governments, individuals, students, exactly as partly these people were, or groups have been mobilized in the campaign for my and Adnan's release. But this is not just enough to demand someone's release. I think the key issue is free and independent media. I absolutely believe that if in the 90s there would be free and independent global media in Russia established within and outside of Russia, when the internet started to march in all this post-Soviet space, if a very sophisticated network with elements of traditional TV channels and social media, bloggers, citizen journalists would be worked on and would be promoted, if money would be invested in there, if public opinion in, because Gerald was talking about mobilizing public opinion in Europe, and I mean probably you were talking, as I understand, about kind of democracies, right? But I think it's also very essential, and actually to look at the root of the problem. And root of the problem is that public opinion in countries like Azerbaijan and Russia, and you know, and also Ukraine was the case until recently and partly even now, is manipulated by huge investments, you know, huge investments that Kremlin puts in media, in propaganda media. So I think everyone by now realizes, of course, that Europe lost this information war to Putin, but I think now it's time to start doing things in the right way. And I can tell you one small example from Azerbaijan. After I came to Berlin, because I have seen that it is impossible to create infrastructure in Azerbaijan, every NGO is shut down in Azerbaijan, people are jailed, sentenced. So I decided to create infrastructure here in Berlin. And today, within just 1 year, we have 15 people with very small resources. We have 15 people working in Berlin and in Azerbaijan. And we have 10,000 views on YouTube daily. I've done it with very, really, very, very small resources. I absolutely believe that there are enough partners, NGOs, journalists, citizen journalists, businesses, rich people, governments that could do it and should plan it, should start designing. And I think now this is where we can start in ex-Soviet space. We can start a Wikipedia sort of TV network where it will be based in Kiev, but the network itself will be functioning, you know, small bits and parts of it all over ex-Soviet Union space. And we should involve a lot of citizen journalists, bloggers, because in spite of all the repressions, in spite of all the aggression against individual liberties in these countries, in Azerbaijan, in Russia, in Belarus, in Central Asia, in all of these countries, there are still people who are risking their lives and their freedom for and fight for freedom of speech in these countries, for freedom of media, and for release of political prisoners. So this is my contribution to today's debate. I think that we, while again confirming the importance of all the issues that Turgut was talking about and have been listed in this agenda, I think we have to keep in mind the institutional approach in supporting independent media and civil society in these countries is a key to have real results in the years to come. Maybe it will take 1, 2, 5, 10 years, but we have to build this up. Because otherwise, it's not that we are anything like democracy or human rights or individual liberties, they are spreading in the, you know, in Europe. It's just the opposite. It's a far right. It's fascists, you know, are coming to power and getting more popular even in the Western Europe.
Reminding us especially about the role of independent media in counteracting this very strong propaganda that we all encounter in the media space. So now we've heard from our two speakers from Azerbaijan, and we can switch to Russia, to Dmitri Makarov, who is a human rights defender and has very extensive background on the human rights situation in Russia as well as in other post-Soviet countries. So Dmitri, what do you think are the main problems, and what would be some of the good solutions to the situation we have today?
I do come from Russia, but I represent an international youth ingress movement, which is a network working throughout the post-Soviet space. And as I speak now, one of our fellow activists, a member of the network, is actually in prison in Belarus, serving 10 days in prison for participating in Food Not Bombs action. And as we speak here today, there are new searches going on in Moscow within the framework of Bolotnaya case, so-called Bolotnaya case, cracking.
TV network where it will be based in Kiev, but the network itself will be functioning, you know, small bits and parts of it all over ex-Soviet Union space. And we should involve a lot of citizen journalists, bloggers, because in spite of all the repressions, in spite of all the aggression against individual liberties in these countries, in Azerbaijan, in Russia, in Belarus, know of in Central Asia, in all of these countries, there are still people who are risking their lives and their freedom for and fight for freedom of speech in these countries, for freedom of media, and for release of political prisoners. So this is my contribution to today's debate. I think that we, while again confirming the importance of all the issues that Turgut was talking about and have been listed in this agenda, I think we have to keep in mind the institutional approach in supporting independent media and civil society in these countries is a key to have real results in the years to come. Maybe it will take 1, 2, 5, 10 years, but we have to build this up. Because otherwise, it's not that we're anything like democracy or human rights or individual liberties, they are spreading in the, you know, in Europe. It's just the opposite. It's a far right, it's fascist, you know, are coming to power and getting more popular even in the Western Europe.
Thanks a lot, Emin, for reminding us especially about the role of independent media in counteracting this very strong propaganda that we all encounter in the media space. So now we've heard from our two speakers from Azerbaijan, and we can switch to Russia, to Dmitri Makarov, who is a human rights defender and has very extensive background on the human rights situation in Russia as well as in other post-Soviet countries. So Dmitri, what do you think are the main problems and what would be some of the good solutions to the situation we have today?
I do come from Russia, but I represent an international youth human rights movement, which is a network working throughout the post-Soviet space. And as I speak now, one of our fellow activists and of the network is actually in prison in Belarus, serving 10 days in prison for participating in food not bombs action. And as we speak here today, there are new searches going on in Moscow within the framework of Bolotnaya case, so-called Bolotnaya case, cracking down on those who have demonstrated against Putin's inauguration back in May 6, 2012. To respond to the authoritarian international of dictatorships with the new human rights international, then things, problems that are going on with human rights in Belarus are just as much a problem for Russians and Ukrainians as the problems that they have in their own countries. But the problems of Azerbaijan are not only the subject of concern of people from Azerbaijan, but also of those who are working on similar issues in other countries as well. And I think, I mean, a lot has been said already in the media and in public discussions about the recent developments in Russia, about Putin regime, that is becoming more and more authoritarian. But I think it's quite easy to lay blame on Putin himself and on Russia in particular. But I think we need to look at other issues that have been allowed such things to happen. I think Putin is a Russian phenomenon, but Schröder and Schröderization of politics is a German phenomenon. Front National is a French phenomenon and a European phenomenon. Jobbik is also a European party. And it's no surprise that those parties that I've mentioned have sent their observers to legitimize the so-called referendum in Crimea, for instance, and have been in close alliance with the United Russia and the ruling party in Russia. And I think one other message that I wanted to voice now in the presentation that opened this panel, there was a mention of the Helsinki movement that has helped to shape the human rights landscape of the European continent, that has helped to bring the OSCE together to what to pay attention to the human dimension basket of security. I think it's time to remember that the Helsinki movement has been started in the Soviet Union by the great dissidents that have actually brought a government to live to the things, to the standards that has put on paper. And it is by no coincidence that the first Helsinki movement, Helsinki Group, was actually founded in Moscow by the name of Moscow Helsinki Group. And it is no coincidence that American Helsinki Group was also founded by the same person that was among the founders of Moscow Helsinki Group, Emin Milli, who is still one of the most respected human rights activists living today. American Helsinki Group was the one to become Human Rights Watch later on. And I think it is important to remember that this is history, but it's